Hello everyone, welcome to Inter IT Technique 10.0. This is the presentation session for the mid-prep event, DRDO's UAV guided UGV navigation channel. In the panel, we have Mr. Sudhir Dhamija, Mr. Akshay Jain, and Mr. Kirpal Singh from DRDO. Now the teams will be presenting. Team 10, you please raise your hands. Before that, I would like to tell you, you will be presenting for 10 minutes, followed by a 5-minute Q&A session. At the end of 8 minutes, you will hear this buzzer sound. I hope it is clear.
Hello, Akshay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, I can hear you. I think Muskan
okay,
is talking.
Okay.
Hello everyone, am I audible?
Yes, Muskan, you are audible.
Sorry, there was a network issue from my side. So I'll be telling the instructions again for the team. Team, you will be presenting for 10 minutes, followed by a 5 minutes of Q&A. At the end of 8 minutes, you will hear this buzzer sound. Yeah. So team 10, please raise your hands. Team 10, are all your presenters ready?
Yep. So can we start?
Okay. So your time start. You'll
start. I'll just share the screen. Yeah. Just one sec. Is the screen visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. Hello.
Okay, team. Hello. Yeah.
Am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Okay. Do we need to switch on our videos as well?
Yes, better if you can do that.
Okay, team. So should we start?
All right, okay,
now so your time starts now.
All right, so good morning everyone. We are team 10 and today we are going to present our approach for DRDO's UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. The problem had an interesting component of cooperativeness between the UAV and the UGV in a very real world setting. Moving on, we'll talk about the overview of our approach. The first part of the statement required us to use the drone to map the road on a mountainous terrain. A driving factor for us was to ensure that a solution is efficient with lightweight algorithms. For mapping the road, we use point clouds to detect it and then traverse the road by sampling points to get a mean path and then using a state machine to help the drone traverse along it. The second phase of the problem had interesting constraints as well. The UGV does not have any sensors, so in order to guide the UGV with our created map, we use our drone to provide visual feedback. Through this, we can extract the position and velocity of the UGV and use the controller to ensure that it follows the road in a safe manner. Now, moving on with our approach, for mapping the road, we make use of planar segmentation algorithms. Subsequently, we construct some rules based on heuristics on how to move ahead after segmenting the road using some basic geometry and principal component analysis to determine the direction. Now, the points on the road are in the camera frame, and we also need to apply some transformations to convert it into the map frame and then store it. Now, the controller module makes use of visual feedback from the drone and helps the UGV traverse along the generated points. In the next couple of slides, you can find the RQT graph for the segmentation portion and the UGV, the guidance portion. Now, in the next slide, we'll talk a little more about what the main nodes are doing. So, the road segmentation algorithm works on the point cloud obtained from the RGBD camera and segments planes from it using the RANSAC algorithm. The mean path is then generated from the points and the traversal of the drone is managed via the state machine, via the mapping FSM node. So the basic idea is that at a stage, the drone is hovering and it detects the road. It gets a point to go ahead. It gets a new point from the mean path. We use the state machine to command the drone to go there and stabilize before it detects the road again and starts traversing. Now, the next slide presents the controller nodes. The guidance phase makes use of a controller to help the UGV reach the mapped waypoints. A pure pursuit logic is used along with the PID controller, and the detection and localization nodes are used to detect the drone and estimate its velocity and position to provide visual feedback. Now we'll go into the vision and control algorithms in depth.
Talking about the road segmentation, we get a point cloud from the depth camera which is fixed to the drone, and we utilize the PCL library's RANSAC algorithm to get what are the three most prominent planes in that point cloud. So our task is to compute that which of these planes is the road and which of these are extraneous. So for each of the planes, we compute an average slope value and also apply a small size penalty. The reasoning being that if a plane is really very small, then the chances that it is a road are fewer, and thus a penalty would be quite appropriate. Now, based on this average slope value, we sort the planes. And after sorting the planes, we have one of two situations in front of us. The first situation is that the ranking we get is quite conclusive. The average slope values are far apart, and we can clearly tell that the plane with the lowest average slope value happens to be the road. In that case, we pick that plane, and we also update our PrevZ value, which essentially stores the average depths of the last few iterations of this process, of the average depths of the last few times that we detected the road. So the updation is in this mathematical formula, and the process and its use will be given shortly. In the second case, the ranking is uncertain and inconclusive, so we need to apply time-based filtering to get around this. So using the PrevZ value, which stores the average of the last few depths that we've detected, we compute the compute the average depth for each of the planes, and we take the plane whose the average depth is the closest to this PrevZ value. So the reasoning is that in two subsequent time steps, we do not expect that the depth of the road will change by a very drastic amount. So this allows us to build quite a robust solution for the same. Again, like previous time, we also update the PrevZ value. So now after that, we move on to mean path detection after we segmented which pixels belong to the road and which do not. So the situation, again, we utilize three cascading situations in order to get around this. The first situation is when a major part of the image is occupied by the road. In that case, it is reasonable to expect that the drone is somewhere very close to the center of the road, and hence the road dominates the image. So we ask the drone to go along the direction it was going, and that's pretty much what you see in this image. The second case is when the road is not very dominant, but we can get a really good rectangular fit for the road. So we try to find the rectangle which bounds the road with the minimum area, and the axis of that rectangle is the direction along which we want the drone to go. So if the two are close together in the area, that is the road and the minimum bounding rectangle that we found, we use this method. In that case, if that fails and we do not get a good rectangular fit, we move on to principal component analysis, and that provides us the direction in the last case along which we want our drone to travel. In the methods that we've used, we've also introduced a corrective measure thing. And this is implemented in case if the when the drone strays too far from the image from the road center, which is the same by seeing how far the image center is from the drone is from the center of the road that we've detected. If the distance is too big, then we ask the drone to move in such a way as to clear that offset and get back towards the center of the road. This corrective measure is not included in the waypoints that we give to the players, because this is a measure that makes sure that the drone keeps the road in frame, and it's not really supposed to be a waypoint for the players. So this was our algorithm for going about detecting the mean path.
So here's an overview of the UGV guided by the UAV. There are three inputs to the whole control system, namely the mean path generated in the first step, the maximum velocity of the Prius, which has kept constant in our state, the drone's current position, and there are various controllers for executing the whole process, the details of which will be explained in the later slides. We have used a pure pursuit controller for following the path in combination with a PID velocity controller. The pure pursuit controller takes into account the heading angle, the next waypoint in the range of the look-ahead distance. Look-ahead distance is the distance for which the Prius can search for its next waypoint. And this control returns the steer angle required to keep following the given path. heading angle of the Prius is obtained by the visual feedback by the UAV, and to keep a better track of the part and to reduce oscillations, the parameters need to be tweaked. The second part is the PID velocity controller, which is responsible for attaining the desired velocity. This takes into account the current velocity of the Prius, which is obtained by the visual odometry tool, and it turns the required throttle or brake to attain the desired velocity.
Okay, so moving on, we consider the two important points that our UGV does not have any sensors, and for us to traverse our UGV on any mountainous road, we would need to attach a controller to it, and a controller would require the continuous pose and orientation of the UGV. So for that, we begin with UGV detection, which utilizes the RGB information from the RGBD camera to perform some simple color-based detection algorithm that would prove enough for our case. We just use these simple CV algorithms to detect the Prius, then detect the corners of the Prius, the center, and the front middle point, so that we have continuous pose and orientation from the visual feedback provided by the UAV. Moving on to localization, we realize that we have multiple frames in our case, and we perform all our localization in the world frame, which is basically the frame which is the home position or where the R2 pilot up firmware spawns the quad rotor. So we perform these simple use simple rotation matrices to perform the necessary transformations between these frames. Also, we note that the Prius velocity is just calculated by using the two consecutive pose calculations that are again done using the visual feedback. For the tracking part, we see that it is very essential that the UGV is always in the field of view of the UAV, because we need that continuous pose from the visual feedback. So for that, the UAV is given a set velocity point, which is in accordance with the UGV. Also, we, as it's seen in the code base shown, we maintain that the UAV is under 20 meters at all times from the road. When we see our performance analysis, we designed our algorithm to be efficient in terms of the earlier grading scheme that considered computation usage. And we can see that at most, at any point of time in our whole system, 3 cores are used. And we perform these simulations on an i7 10th gen laptop, which is kind of equivalent to an Intel NUC, which is a industry level drone onboard processor.
Team, then your time is up.
Yeah, that's it from our side. Thank you.
Judges, we can start with the Q&A session.
Yeah, hello, good morning. So, whatever you proposed, it was a very good solution. But yesterday, what I could see was in the world run, then your UGV was ahead of UAV. So it was not able to move ahead. Right?
Yes, sir. Like, because the UAV was spawned before the UGV, it was not able to detect, because we had worked the initial case that the UAV spawned on top of the UGV itself. So we had started from there. I mean, like, if the UAV had a higher height than 20 meters, it could have detected the UGV as well if it spawned before. But our initial case was that it was spawned on top of the UGV. So that was what we were expecting in the testing world as well. So that was the case.
Okay, so what do you propose now?
So in terms of what? Like the starting case?
Yeah, so that this kind of problem doesn't exist.
Okay, so I think this initial case was discarded because some teams and initially us also were facing the problem that the drone wasn't arming. So that was basically because when the in the Zemo simulation environment, I'm just talking about the simulation, not the real case scenario here. When the UAV was spawned on top of the UGV, it was not starting and it was moving. So so due to that, the mission planner that we have, for example, say Q ground control, it has a check for gyro calibration. And if the drone is moving at its initial spawn point, the gyros won't calibrate and the GPS won't lock, and the drone would simply fail to arm. So we had to just disable the gyro calibration, and the drone used to arm and like fly normally. Like, that was the case.
Okay. Akshay, any question from your side?
Yeah. So taking that forward, so you are giving a feedback from UAV to your UGV. So what all data is going from UAV to UGV, and how much data rates you think it's required to maintain that link? I'm talking the perspective if I want to implement the solution in the real time.
Right. Okay. So basically what we need for the UGV is its pose, velocity and orientation. So like velocity is needed for the PID velocity controller because we need our current velocity and we are moving our UGV at a target set velocity. So we need the velocity for that. We need the pose because we need to calculate for the look ahead distance explanation that we have for the pure person part of the algorithm, and orientation because we need to align our drone to the UGV so that we have a proper detection at all times. So these are the three things that we require for the UGV and is provided from the visual feedback from the UAV. And so what was the second question? The publish rates.
How much data rate, the link, communication link has to be there between the UAV and the UGV, no? So you are sending the text values or you are sending the images to UGV to navigate, or you are doing all the processing onboard UAV?
Okay. So what we do is like the pose and orientation velocity are fed into the controller. And to the UGV, we only send the values of the throttle and the brake. Okay. Because that is only that we are allowed to send to the UGV because we don't have anything else on it.
Achha. So you are sending the throttle and brake values for every instant to the UGV, or you can fed the UGV with these values for say for some time. So for next 1 minute or 2 minutes, these are the values you need to follow. You can do that?
No, sir. I'm afraid not. Like we have to send it continuously.
So in that case, if you can do that, if there is a link breakage or if there is a misalignment between the position of your UGV and UAV, you still will be able to move the UGV.
The UGV, okay, I'm afraid not. So what we had done for now was that in the time constraint that we had, if the UGV goes out of frame of the UAV because it's a mountainous road and in a real life scenario, we need to consider the safety aspect as well, we just stop the UGV and the UAV tries to return its to return to its previous waypoint.
Okay.
So that is what we have written in the code for now. We could think some better solutions as well, but that is what we had done in the time that we had.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
One more question.
Yes.
You were showing the algorithm to find the midpoint, the center point of the road.
Of the road, yes.
Yeah. So what happens when there is a 180 degree turn on the road?
Okay. I'll let my teammate take that.
Yeah. So the algorithms that we had, as you can see in the runs, in the videos that we submitted, the algorithms were able to follow normal curves decently. But, and this is also explained in the scope for improvement, that our algorithm failed on the second world just before the U-turn because we were facing some issues because the U-turn was a very steep decline. So the point cloud wasn't, it was just getting the road in front of it. And the point, we weren't getting the curve in the point cloud, in the plane segmented. So because of that, the three approaches that we run to get the mean point weren't running very well. That's why this approach currently was failing. And the scope for improvement there was to add an exploration routine when we can notice that the drone is stuck in a particular position. So we can add an exploration routine to like maybe just move ahead or explore the surroundings and then continue with the same algorithm.
Yeah, so actually when I saw your videos and yesterday also, it just stopped before the turn. And also in your presentation, it was clear that it will actually not go ahead from the turn. So that is why I asked that question. So yeah, now you know that the scope for improvement. So
about the final testing world, yeah, I think we can add one point there. The worlds that we were given for the practice had very steep slopes like we have in a mountainous terrain. So and that's how we got this idea for the time-based filtering, that in two subsequent time steps, the average depth of the road is not going to change by much, right? But in the final testing world, what happened was there was a steep slope, but the mountainous terrain that we had there was very low. So when we got to the turn, ideally what would have happened was the slope would have been very steep and the drone would have kept detecting the road and would have taken a turn and moved along. But in this case, what happened was, because the height difference was very less, the time-based filtering that we provided wasn't able to work very well, and the drone then started detecting the mountainous part as the road.
Okay.
So that's the difference. Like, we had our parameters calibrated according to some practice worlds that we had, and like, there was this slight difference in the final world that we found, so because of which the algorithm wasn't able to work as well.
Okay. Not a problem. So it was actually only 3 weeks, and your team did a pretty well job. So congratulations to you.
Thank you very much, sir.
Now we can go ahead with the other team. Thank you, Team 10.
Thank you, sir.
Team 13, please raise your hands.
Akshay, you can send me the marks. Muskan, which team is next?
Sir, team 13 is next. I'm just inviting them on stage.
Okay. No, I just wanted the number.
Team 13, the instructions are, the presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of 8 minutes, you will hear this buzz around, and when 10 minutes are over, I'll inform you. You can start, you can present your screen, and then we can start the time. Okay, team 13, your time starts now.
Good morning, everyone. We are team 13, and we'll be presenting our solution for the problem statement UAV guided UGV navigation. Now let us start with the takeoff of the UAV. Next slide. Takeoff. We use DroneKit for takeoff and landing. DroneKit is a Python library that helps you to communicate with Autopilot. We chose this as it is easier than controlling the UAV directly. We took the UAV to a height of 15 meters, as this is the best suited height for the camera to see the whole road. For moving the UAV, we used Mavros to connect Autopilot with ROS. DroneKit was publishing messages in the local frame instead of body frame. This was an issue for us. So instead of using the pre-compiled binary version of Mavros, we have installed it from source and changed the frame from local net to body net. Later, we used them to publish Mavros CMD topic, and we used it as UAV velocity.
Coming to UAV maneuvering. Maneuvering the UAV was undoubtedly the essential most job for our proposed setting to work. Processing the depth image was a significant part of it. as we will be talking about the use of depth images for our purposes multiple times in this presentation, I'll go a step further to explain the implemented scheme at the very start itself. The depth images are converted into pseudo grayscale images. It is a format which allows us to apply OpenCV functionalities and also provides us with more cognitive intuition of what exactly is happening. The pseudo grayscale image, I'll use the term depth image for it from now on, is segmented into different classes for our purposes, the classes being road and not road. The depth image before subjection to segmentation is convoluted with a Gaussian filter for noise dilution and handling the other values that might affect the segmentation process. The segmentation is done through the k-mean segmentation algorithm, making distinct pixels available clustered into two using the grayscale image's pixel value. Our task is to traverse over the areas of the road class, and for this we work on the local frame of the drone and find the midpoints of the road class along the axis of the motion of the drone. The midpoints when joined result in the creation of a guiding line. We call it so because our drone is operated by a line following algorithm based on PID control, enabling the drone to move exactly on the created line. As you can see, we have in this slide the original RGB image, and beside it is the segmented depth image with the guiding line created on it. Now, how do we determine which one of the two segmented classes is the road class? We work under a naive assumption that the majority class in the vision of the depth camera will be the road class, provided that the drone starts from a position directly above the road and follows the road as well. This assumption works very efficiently. The scheme does not take into account the texture or the color of the mountainous environment. Hence, it is independent of the changes in the same, which makes this approach very versatile and readily applicable to different types of terrains. In this scheme, UAV needs only traverse once. A simultaneous run of the UAV along with UGV is not required, and it will be explained in the further slides.
Moving forward to UGV navigation. The approach is the velocity components given to the UAV are provided as instructions to the UGV when the UAV completes the path. Since the UGV does not have any sensors or controllers, we use ROSBAG as a tool to record the messages of the velocity topic while the UAV is traversing the line-guided path. Later, when the UAV has traversed the path, we subscribe to the velocity topic of the UAV and published it to the UGV prior topic, providing us control over the mobility of the UGV. All the technicalities being discussed here are in the local frame of the UAV. So now, coming to how we approach the optimization process. The linear velocity X component of the UAV is scaled and given as throttle input to the UGV. In contrast, the angular Z velocity component is provided as steer input after scaling. Coming to the next slide, the flow chart here describes our entire approach. The UAV takes off from the ground to a height of 15 meters using the help of DroneKit. Next, we are running a Python script that creates a line-guided path that the UAV follows and explores the whole world. While the UAV traverses the path, the velocity topic and corresponding messages are recorded and stored in a ROSBAG. The recorded bag file is played and the messages of the drone velocity are published. A Python script is used to subscribe the velocity topic of the UAV. And messages are published to UGV prior topic after proper scaling of the velocity components.
Now, let's see how
Actually, our team member is not audible, so I'll be taking over from Novelty. So coming back to Novelty, let's see how our solution is different and an approach. Our breakpoint was using the depth images for segmentation. We know that depth image by itself will give us a specific color depending on the height. Now, since all the points on the road are at the same level, or assumed to be at the same level, it belongs to a single class. Hence, the road will always be of a single class, irrespective of the color of the texture or the terrain. Thereby, we can always detect the road and follow it. This leads to the generalization of the UAV movement in all kinds of worlds, like the ones given. Next slide, please. Now, for connecting the UAV with UAV, we use ROSBAC, which records the movements of the UAV and simply feeds them to UGV to make it move in the same manner. There were a few challenges faced while solving this problem statement. Initially, we used the RGB images that didn't do too well in distinguishing between the terrain and the road. Hence, we shifted to use of the depth images for this task. As you can see, there are three pictures on the top. The leftmost one is the RGB image. The one beside it is the depth image. And the rightmost one is the segmented image of the two classes obtained from the depth image. Next, we had an erroneous road detection. If the UAV was too close, we solved it by fixing the relative distance between the road and the UAV. UAV should change height as per the slopes of the road. Finally, we solved the problem of sending messages to the UAV with the help of ROSBACs. These were the essential checkpoints we reached, and now Shankar will continue.
Scope of improvement. These are the possible improvements which we can make for this problem statement. First one, reducing the time between taking the images and moving the UAV resulted in some delay caused by the processing time of the image. We have methods available to reduce the computation with us now, which we couldn't have implemented due to which we would not have like which we could have implemented, but we were not able to do because of time constraints. Slopes of the road also need to be taken into account in our implementation. We have taken into account only the relative altitude of the road from the road. A simple storing and subtracting on the same can do that. The camera provided to us was very unstable, so improving the stability of the camera while moving the UAV by reducing the tilt in X and Y directions helps us in reducing the errors in imagery. More precise of scaling of velocities while converting the twist messages into control messages was required and can be implemented to improve the accuracy of motion of UGV. Fifth one is improvement in approximating the errors in the PID controller for better stability while moving the car. These are the implementations we can make in our submission. Some of these we have already tried to implement, and some of them we need more time. Thank you. Now we are open for questions.
Very good, team 13. So just tell me one thing, like what failed?
Yes, sir. Coming to that point, actually the error was not really in our approach. It was one of the bugs in our code. Since we talked about how we are segmenting the depth image into two classes, which the majority class being the road class. So what was happening was we were trying to find the midpoint of every single pixel array in the axis in which our drone has to move. So the issue was, what if there was no road class in some of the last few pixel arrays of the given image? So while the submission of code, we did not take that into account. So what happened was, when we ran our code in the new environment, due to some steep turns, the thing was, we lost the road class at the bottommost part of the image, and our code started giving some errors. That was the thing what happened. If we could have just replaced one for loop, we would have removed that error. So that was
okay. But I could see in the solution yesterday that the drone could map up to a distance, but this UGV was continuously going off the road as soon as it started.
So that was
because the error in passing the path to the UGV or something.
Sir, that was because of reason of the scalability, because the messages type what we have recorded was twist, And the messages, what the UGV needs is control messages, and the range of the messages are different. So while scaling these twist messages into control messages, there was some issue. We have not properly scaled the control messages. Else, this approach could be very good because we have just taken into account the velocities. So just providing the velocities would be very good. Only the scalability issue is led to the UGV failure.
Okay. So what is the best part of your solution? You just tell me one. This is my USP, unique selling point.
Okay, sir. So the best part of our approach would be, like, we are using the depth images for direct segmentation. There's no single part which involves the which includes the use of RGB image, which would provide us with the texture and color information of the terrain. So the thing was, since we are using the depth image for segmentation and finding the midpoints of the same, this approach can be readily applied to any terrain which has such a difference of roads and valleys and mountains in it, and we can find the midpoint of the road, which would provide us with the path which our drone has to traverse. And since we were recording the movements of the drone and providing the same to the UGV, so that the UGV may traverse the same path, like, that reduces the scope of error which would come. So that is one thing which was the best part of our approach.
Aditya, actually, this is the reason I asked you this question, because in the PPT also you said the same point. Actually, I differ on this particular part. See, if you take only the depth image, so whenever there is a plain terrain and there is a road going over it, see, generally when it is traversing in the mountains, so it is not always slopes. Sometimes the valleys also come. Okay, so in those valleys there are open roads. On both side of the road there is some empty. Some empty land is there. The road doesn't always start from the slope and end in a valley. There are some open areas along the road. So if you take only the depth image, it will not solve your purpose. Actually, it will always take you towards the valley. It can make you slip off the road sometimes. So the better solution was to also incorporate the RG image into it. Okay. So I won't say that it is basically, you might not have gone to those kind of places. So these kind of scenario you must have missed. But yeah, taking the depth image and then doing the processing over it, it was no doubt a good solution. But actually it will not work in those kind of terrains.
Yes, sir.
So it should be a combination of the both.
Yes, sir. Incorporation of RGB images in the code would have improved our solution as well. Yeah. But as for the valley part, like the first world and the second world, I do not know how steep valleys there were, but we had the environment set up in a terrain like where there were valleys available. But using the same approach, we were able to traverse the entire world. So,
yeah. In world 1 and 2, actually, it was a very slope, like very steep roads on the slopes.
Yes, sir. So
that is how it could work well.
Yes, sir. So given those environments, so we were only familiar with that type of environment. So that might have been the case.
Yeah, exactly. That is what I'm saying. Not your mistake, but just only the familiarization issue. Not a problem. Yes. But as such, your solution was very good. So I congratulate your whole team.
Thank you, sir. We'll try to incorporate in future such approaches.
Any other questions from the team members? Akshay or Kirpal?
Yeah. So what you have proposed is that you are transferring the velocity values from UAV to UGV. So what I understood, your UGV is trying to mimic the motion of your UAV in time scales, in a time sequence. So for time T1, if UAV has a velocity V1, then UGV also tries to achieve that velocity. For time 2, then another set of velocity, time 3, another set of velocity. So doing this in an open loop environment, it's very difficult because UAV is flying over air and UGV has to cross the roads and roads are not very smooth, or obstructions may also be there practically. So what do you think, how you can improve on that?
Since we maintained our UGV at a constant relative height from the ground, we were easily able to calculate the slopes of the roads that occurred in the terrain. So for that purposes, since the slopes are recorded, the velocities of the drone are already recorded, and we limited our drone or UAV, the motions of our drone or UAV in such a manner that it only moves in those degrees of freedom in which a UGV would move. So what that enabled us was, initially UAV tried to mimic how the UGV would move in such a terrain. And since slopes are already calculated, we already know when to apply brakes, when to increase the speed. So those things, if properly optimized, can be implemented into the solution, and the margin of practical errors can be reduced by a significant value.
Okay. No further questions, sir.
Okay. So thank you, Team 13. Muskan, we can go ahead with the next team.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Team 5, please raise your hands.
Muskan, I hope they have submitted the PPTs.
Yes, sir, they have submitted the PPTs. Team 5, I'll go ahead with the instructions. So you will be presenting for 10 minutes. At the end of 8 minutes, you will hear this buzzer sound. And by the end of your presentation, I'll inform you. So, yes.
Muskan, please accept presenter 1's request.
I have sent the invitation to the to presenter 1. He hasn't accepted yet. Presenter 1, please accept the invitation request. Presenter 1, please accept the invitation request.
Just a second, we can see.
Seems like it was too early for presenter 1 in the morning.
You could not see the invite.
You could not see the invite? Okay, I have sent the invite.
Can anyone else from you start with the presentation?
Just a minute, sir. I think I'll invite again. I have sent the invite again. Please check. Yeah, I think he is there. So, team 5, can we? Your time starts now. Team 5, your time starts. Team 5. Your presenter 1 is still not here.
Sorry, am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you. Greetings to everyone. Greetings to esteemed panel of judges and everyone present here. Today we are presenting our work on the DRDO UAV-UGV Navigation Challenge on behalf of our Team 5. Our primary motivation for the given problem is the relevance to the national security and the road network in the mountainous regions of the country. The road network are covered in the snow for long durations. Further, the terrain is blocked by terrain blocks the GPS, making the various navigation applications ineffective. Such critical conditions also challenge the maintenance vehicles due to poor visibility. Such conditions make road travel accident prone and military for both military and civilian vehicles. Prior to the modules proposed in our solution, we introduced the concept of the frame of transformations by first highlighting the gazebo frame of reference, the local frame of reference, both of which are rigidly mounted together. Then we introduced the UAV body frame of reference, which is rigidly attached to the UAV, and the camera frame of reference. Lastly, we have the UGV frame of reference, which is rigidly attached to the ground vehicle. We chose the local frame of reference to develop our solution, as it is rigidly as it has rigid transformations with the world frame. We now discuss the first module, that is lane detection, where we first calculate the surface normals of the region in the frame by finding the image derivatives on the depth map. We then segment the RGB based image and fuse these two images by a pixel wise AND. We apply morphological transformations to smoothen out the mask and take single largest component representing our lane. We find the boundaries of the lane by edge detection and on the largest component, and we fit the B-spline to smoothen out the irregularities of each of these edges. Lastly, we take the mean of these two splines to find the trajectory representing the middle of the lane, and these points are then projected in the local coordinate frame. We now present the path planning module of our solution.
In this module, we make the UAV follow the road and generate the waypoints for the UGV to follow. We first take a look at this first frame seen by the drone. We assume that the car is visible in this frame, and from the UGV localization module explained later, we get the orientation of the car to find which direction is forward. Now focusing on the center image, the purple spline that we see in the middle is the is provided by the lane detection module. This blue circle here is the current UAV location. Since we're trying to bring the drone towards the lane, new waypoints are selected from the purple spline. We take the following approach. First, the nearest point on the spline from the UAV is taken. Then a threshold circle is taken around this point. This threshold circle ensures that each waypoint is sufficiently spaced out. Two points are sampled just outside these circle and are candidate waypoints. To make sure, we make use of a reference vector to choose between these two waypoints. In the first frame, our reference vector is the orientation of the car. And in the subsequent frames, the reference vector is the vector between the two previous waypoints. This is to make sure progress is only made in the forward direction. So now that the first waypoint is selected, the UAV starts moving towards it. Only after reaching this new waypoint, a frame is processed and a new waypoint is produced. It is continued till the end is reached. We then provide these waypoints to phase two of our solution to guide the UGV like shown in this animation. We now move on to the UGV localization module.
In this module, for detecting the UGV in the snowy background, we take the segmented image of the lane provided by the depth camera. After thresholding the segmented image of the lane, we obtain contours and perform contour detection. We fit a rotated rectangle box of the smallest area around the contour after deleting contours with area outside of a particular range. As there can be false detections, we implement some checks to eliminate the inaccurate detections. In order to eliminate false detections, we check the eccentricity obtained by fitting an ellipse around the detected contours. As the car has a fixed length and width, the eccentricity remains almost constant and we can eliminate obstacles whose shape is like the UGV. Now, we have eliminated all obstacles other than the UGV. We use image moments to detect the center of the car using the detected contour mask. The problem remaining now is to find the heading angle of the UGV. As the UGV is curved on its front side, it covers a lesser area of the rotated rectangle in the front half. We subtract the mask of this rectangle from the contour and use image moments to reveal the front side of the UGV. We then project these points from the image frame to the real-world coordinates, and these are used for the navigation of the UGV. We now move on to the next module, which is control navigation.
So this module receives the raw global path from the first phase initial mapping of the world. This global path has non-uniformly placed waypoints and might have a few outliers. To address this, we fit a fifth order degree polynomial spline on the data and extract equidistant waypoints, which are then fed to the controller. Given the route's intricate layout, which includes steep slopes and hairpin twists, a geometric controller would lead to suboptimal results. A model predictive controller, on the other hand, predicts the UGV's course to ensure a smooth traversal. MPC works by calculating the optimal control actions for a prediction horizon of n at any sampling instant t, applying just the first control action, measuring its new state, and repeating the procedure in an online optimization loop. The added features include a parameter for increasing or decreasing speed based on the slope of the road, as well as an adaptive resolution path for faster computation and high speeds on wide and straight roads. To control the UAV, there are two possibilities for the coordinated motion of the drone and the UGV. The first option is to employ waypoint-based control. However, this would result in a jerky motion as the drone accelerates and decelerates to match the UGV's location. Our method employs a high-level velocity-based control that smoothens the drone's trajectory while following the UGV. Further, the drone-based localization of the UGV contains some noise. To get improved state estimations, we employ an extended Kalman filter along with a tailored noise rejection module based on the UGV's physical constraints. Next, we move on to the final results.
Here we show the collective results from both mapping and navigation phase of the World 1. On the left, we show the top view of the world, and on the right, we show the top-down projection on the path. The plot includes the UAV path and the UGV tracked path. As a performance metric, we show the cross-track error, that is the perpendicular distance between the tracked path and the current and the desired path of the UGV. We clearly see that error is always in an acceptable range. In the next slide, we show the UAV following the UGV. We show the depth map and the segmentation image. We particularly visualize the segmentation due to its pivotal role in UGV pose estimation and spline evaluation for path planning. Lastly, we show the results for World 2 with the same cross-track error. And here as well, we can see the error is in acceptable ranges at all times. In conclusion, our method achieves robust segmentation due to the fusion of color space and surface normal-based segmentation. The reliable segmentation provides long-term deployment of our approach. We employ path planning and backstopping detection to ensure mapping and of unexplored regions only, making our path planning efficient and time optimal with minimal to no backtracking. The proposed real-time UGV localization is morphological transformations and gradient-based approach only, thus making it a real-time solution with frame rates as high as 30 FPS with bottlenecking only from the camera input frequency. This further ensures the real-time feedback and control to be real-time during the navigation phase. A controller also takes into account of the predictive nature and makes an informed decision on the optimal for the optimal performance. Lastly, we show some of the future scopes.
Your time is up. Your time is up.
Thank you. Any questions?
Can you go back to the scope slide once more? Just 1 second. Junctions and bifurcations. Okay. Fine. So my question is, you have included many algorithms here. So how computationally intensive your solution would be? Like others have only taken up the depth image to find the mean line and everything, but you have also included the RGB depth maps. So how computationally intensive from the point of view of a drone?
Yes, sir. I would like to answer the question. But there would be particularly two algorithms which are most computationally expensive. One is the B-spline evaluation using the lane masks, and another would be the optimization for the MPC. The B-spline detection, is although expensive, but we limit that by only limiting the points in the spline to be 50, and which provides us a frame rate of up to 8 to 10 FPS, which is sufficient for real-time operation of the UGV. Further, for MPC optimizations, we also limit the horizon such that we get final output with up to 15 to 20 FPS. And other than this, including, as you mentioned, the RGB segmentations, are only based on the image gradients and further clustering, which are also real-time operations. This makes our whole solution to run between 20 FPS, 15 to 20 FPS as well, including we repeat some of the inputs from the B-spline if they do not match the FPS.
So is it possible using some onboard GPUs?
Yes, this solution is possible to like implement on GPUs, although our current solution does not mandate the use of GPU. However, it can be modified in a way that it is optimized for GPUs and.
Okay, what kind of GPU do you suggest onboard UAV?
So, can you repeat the question, please? Sorry.
What kind of board will be sufficient on the UAV so that all your algorithm can be implemented?
That's a very appropriate question in terms of the aerial robots. I think anything between Jetson Xavier NX or Jetson TX2, such boards can be optimal for running our algorithm. And this is particularly also optimal because aerial robots would need small computers, and Jetson and Xavier NX or Xavier TX2 boards are very spatially and weight optimized,
okay,
as well as GPU optimizations.
Okay. And what about on the UGV? So, okay, UGV can be anything. Okay, very good. So, really impressed with your solution. And yesterday I told you to mix that particular video with overlay on. So, were you able to do it?
Yes, sir. Our team member would like to present the video for that case as well.
What is that? Are you going to present?
Yes, sir. We would like to present the video in the meantime. Yeah, I think you would be able to see the video now. I hope the video is visible. So in this video, you would also see the drone or the car would be waiting for each other to coordinate.
What is the velocity of this vehicle at this particular moment? Any idea about that?
So we are moving at the speeds of around 4 to 5 meters per second.
Okay. Now just stop here. So this is just behind, this is what, depth image? That the left bottom quarter.
So the left bottom image is basically the fused mask from the RGB as well as the depth image.
Okay.
So there can be some regions which may not fully overlap and may create such blobs.
Okay. So now this is the image that the processor is using? Because like this particular UGV was totally inside this particular shadow. So how could you?
Yes, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So for the detection of the UGV, I think we are using this image. So the splines are not used in the second phase. They are only used in the first phase to generate the path.
Okay.
And I think we can further better answer the UGV detection.
It's okay. Keep moving.
Yeah. Also at the same time, like we predict some states in the MPC. So just in case that for a few seconds we do not have the states from the detection, we use the predicted states along with the Kalman filter.
So what happens next? Does the car goes off the road or it moves along the road?
The rear-end factor falls again. This happens at the same instant every time.
No, from here, does this follows the road or it goes off the road? Because the direction now...
Does follow the road. The car has been waiting for the drone and the drone will be moving first. Then it gets localized again. And it will start following the road, but it will be
really slow. Have you generated that particular error graph that you were showing for our roads?
We didn't make a graph for this, but we can send it to you.
Okay. Any other questions from other panelists?
I would just like to congratulate team for very well thought of algorithm. Well done. No questions.
Thank you, Emil, sir. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Team 5.
Now we'll...
Thank you, sir.
Now we'll move ahead with teammate. Teammate, please raise your hands.
Which team is next, Muskan? Come again.
So team A. Team A. I'm just inviting everyone. I think teammate, you all are here. So your presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of the 8 minutes, you will hear this buzzer sound. And after your time is up, I'll inform you. It would be followed by a Q&A session. So you can start presenting. Then we can start the time. Teammate, can you start presenting? Present kar raha hai kya unko? Someone else from your team present. Teammate, can you please start presenting?
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible. Okay, teammate, your time starts now.
Good morning, judges, and everyone present in the meeting. I, Vatsal Dikshit, along with my teammates from Teammate, will be delivering our presentation for the DRDO UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. The challenge is to develop a combination of unmanned earth moving ground vehicle and a guided unmanned aerial vehicle capable of mapping and navigating a mountainous terrain without collapsing. So these are the system specifications. We have a UAV that is having an RGBD camera for mapping and a GPS and IMU sensor for its navigation and control. We also have a UGV that has no sensors, but its controls are available, that is throttle, steer and brake. These are the tech stack that we have used. The software packages are Ubuntu 18.04, ROS Melodic, Gazebo 9, Ardu Pilot Framework and OpenCV. The major ROS topics are the depth camera to obtain the depth and the RGB feed and point cloud, the MavROS setpoint raw local to control the UAV, and the Prius to instruct the UGV. So this is a proposed solution from our team. We have proposed the solution in 4 steps. First is the UAV path identification, in which depth feed from camera is processed to get the optimal path. Next, the UAV path traversal, in which velocities in various directions are controlled to make the drone follow the optimal path. Then the UGV's pose is estimated with respect to UAV's camera frame, and error signals are generated according to the required pose and orientation. Finally, the UGV is given commands according to the error signal in the previous step, and the UGV and UAV traversed the path together. So let's discuss these steps in further detail. First is the UAV path identification. So the very first step is the UAV path identification, that is flying directly over the middle of the road. In the given environment, there is a unique feature that distinguishes this path from rest of the terrain. That is the uniformity in the depth of road along its width. The rest of the terrain being rugged and varying in height, we obtain a distinguishable transition between the road edges and the surrounding in-depth image obtained from the UAV, and thus we are capable of detecting the correct path. In the RGB image to the right-hand side, the visual features are not that really distinguishable, making the road difficult to detect using image processing techniques. So here is how the masking of the road is done, and the optimal trajectory is identified. As the image is obtained from a depth camera pointed directly downwards from the UAV, the center of this image represents the UAV's position in the XY frame and the vertical axis depicted in the red line. The UAV's current heading. The pixel of the road directly ahead of the center were identified and masked out over a 100 pixel long band. We then find out the center of this band, which in turn gives us the middle of the road just ahead of UAV's current position. Continuously doing so over the entire road as the UAV traverses gives us the mid road trajectory. The angle that the derived road's trajectory depicted in the green line makes with the vertical axis of the image frame is the desired angle by which the UAV should rotate to correct its yaw.
We now move on to the aspects of UAV control and navigation. Using the local, that is the body frame attached to the drone, provided to be the most efficient approach, as the control aspects of the system are greatly simplified without the need of tedious transformations. 4 degrees of freedoms were controlled for efficient traversal and minimal deviation, which were Vx, which is the forward velocity, yaw, which is the anti-clockwise rotation, and Vy and Vz, which are horizontal and vertical velocities based on the right-handed system, as you can see in the image. We can now examine the role of the aforementioned 4 parameters. First is Vx. In the UAV's frame, a forward velocity, which is Vx, was published continuously, which starts the navigation process. Vx was kept constant at 1 meters per second, except at sharp turns, where it was reduced to 0.7 meters per second. Second is yaw. For negotiating turns along the path, it is essential for the UAV to align itself properly so that the forward direction is always along the section of the road. And thus, we manipulate the yaw angle accordingly based on the road center detection process. As you can see in the image, the red line is the drone's current trajectory, which is always forward in its frame. The green line is the line joining the center of the image, that is the UAV's position, to its goal location, that is the center part of the road. And the yaw angle, which we denote by theta, which is the alignment error, is the angle between these two lines. We use a PD controller to drive this angle error to zero by using omega z as the control signal and ensure that the UAV aligns itself properly. Next is Vy. Along with controlling Vx and yaw, we also need to ensure that the UAV does not deviate much from the center. Hence, the horizontal velocity, which is Vy, is also controlled to minimize this deviation. The length of the blue line in this image represents this deviation, which can also be depicted as an error signal y0 minus y, i.e. the horizontal error. We used a P controller to drive this error to zero by taking Vy as the control signal. And lastly, Z, which is the vertical position. For efficient navigation and for respecting the height constraint of 20 meters from the road surface, as mentioned in the problem statement, we decided to fly the UAV at a constant height of 15 meters from the surface. The height of the UAV from the road surface was calculated from the point cloud data published by the depth cam. The error signal Z0 minus Z, which is the difference between the reference height 15 and the current height, which is termed as the vertical error, was driven to zero by using a P controller and by using the vertical velocity Vz as the control signal. By controlling all these parameters simultaneously, we ensured that the UAV follows the road trajectory while deviating minimally from the center. As the UAV navigates through the terrain, its X, Y, and Z positions relative to the takeoff point are stored in 3 arrays. Using these arrays, 2D and 3D plots can be generated, which can be used to study the terrain. However, our algorithm is capable of navigating the UGV without explicitly using these pre-generated maps, so we are just using these as a reference for additional feedback.
After successfully navigating the UGV above the road, the next task is to drive the UGV along the center of the road. Since the problem statement doesn't allow for any sensors to be present on the UGV and at least some sort of feedback is essential in the operation of the UGV, we are using the UAV's RGB camera feed to detect the position and orientation of the UGV. In the plain white overlay worlds, UGV detection through the RGB feed becomes relatively easier and preferable over depth feed owing to the absence of other visual features. We detect the UGV's front and back windshields, which due to being black in color are easily distinguishable from the environment in the RGB image. The line joining the centers of these two windshields will yield the UGV's orientation depicted by the arrowed blue line with respect to the vertical axis of the image frame, which is also the UAV's current heading angle depicted by the dashed green line. The angle between these two lines depicted by the yellow arc gives the deviation between the UAV's trajectory and the UGV's trajectory. Also, the center of this line segment can be assumed with reasonable accuracy to be the center of the UGV depicted by the pink dot. Now that we have figured out where the UGV is, we need to calculate where it should be and how to bridge the gap between this is and should. Since the UGV is essentially expected to show a UAV following behavior, the reference pose of the UGV is to be perfectly aligned with the UAV's trajectory, which is the vertical axis of the image frame, and to be a bit behind, in our case 50 pixels, the UAV's projection in the XY frame, which will also be the center of the image. We have employed two controllers for managing the two error signals. The distance between the UGV's current position and the desired position along the vertical axis of the image frame depicted by the pink line. Second, its deviation from the desired orientation depicted by the orange arc. If these error signals are driven to zero, it can be ensured that the UGV will follow the UAV at all times. To achieve this, a P controller is used for managing the throttle and brake commands of the UGV, where the throttle will be a positive value between 0 and 1 and the brake will be 0 if the UGV is behind its reference position. If the UGV overshoots the reference position, the throttle command is immediately stopped and brakes are applied. For correcting the angle error, a PD controller is used whose value is between minus 1 and 1 depending on the extent of deviation from the reference orientation. Thus, through the algorithm just explained, we can successfully navigate both the UAV and the UGV along the route. In addition to the principal approach shown in the previous slides, we also analyzed and tried out some other ways through which one may be expected to reach a satisfactory solution. First, we tried using third-party mapping packages like ArtaMap and OctoMap for mapping the terrain through the UAV. However, since its navigation solutions based on these packages like MoveBase use 2D occupancy grids, and these packages require tedious and to a large extent unnecessary transforms between different frames, we decided against using this approach. Also, the absence of these packages means a computationally more efficient solution, which although may not be rewarded quantitatively in the marking scheme, but is still always a better approach. Secondly, we tried storing the data pertaining to the UAV's traversal in the first phase in a rossback file and then loading this file in the second phase so that the UAV again travels along the center of the road. However, this approach was found to be impractical because due to the inherent noises in the environment, the UAV showed a significant deviation from the idle path. So, thank you. That's it from our side. Any questions are now welcome.
Teammate, it's a very good job done. Your concepts, like it seems that it should have worked. So, what failed?
So, sir, like in world 1 and also world 2 to a large extent, we were able to navigate both the UAV and the UGV on the, along the center of the road. But what happened yesterday with the test world was that its nature was quite different from the previous worlds which are provided. So, as we mentioned in the presentation also, we work on the basis of a transition in depths on the road and its surroundings. So, yesterday's world, the depths were almost equal for the road and its surrounding. So that's why the masking was not up to the mark, due to which the performance was not satisfactory.
Okay. So what do you suggest? Like what you must have included in this?
So I think instead of just depending upon the depth image to have a more generalized solution, we could have also integrated the RGB image feed into the depth image with some relevant weights. But like, we didn't have any idea about the test well which were going to be provided to us, so we couldn't have foreseen that.
So yesterday I could see that your UAV and UGV, they were both moving simultaneously. Like earlier, the beforehand mapping was not necessary for your solution. So in case now you also include the RGB image, so can your solution work now when the snow is on the road?
Yes, sir. So, sir, currently in our algorithm, we do not require a pre-generated map, as you rightly mentioned. But if we are incorporating a RGB image, definitely a pre-generated map will be required, which we are generating. We are only not using it in the UGV navigation, but since we mentioned in one of the slides also, we are recording the UAV's path as a NumPy array, its X, Y, and Z coordinates. So giving that as local waypoints in the second phase, if we are integrating the RGB image also, we can try to navigate the UGV and the UAV based on that regenerated map.
Okay, that's all from my side. Any other question from other panelists?
What will happen if the link between the UAV and UGV breaks? So how far UGV will go, or it will stop immediately?
So in our algorithm, what we had initially assumed was that the UGV will show basically a drone following behavior. So it always lags behind the UAV in terms of its extent, exposition, the vertical, the forward direction. So that was the case in our world 1 and 2 also. The UGV was always a bit behind the UAV. So the only case where the link was possible to be broken was when the UGV was out of the frame of the UAV. So that is, it lags a lot behind the UAV. So in that case, to correct that, what we have done is we given a constant throttle of one units to the UGV so that it again comes back in the image frame of the UAV. But there is a scope of improvement in that. We can detect the last detected position of the UGV in the image frame, and then based on that, we can publish the grounds.
Okay.
Okay, thank you so much, teammate. We congratulate you for the very good work that you have done. So we would have hoped that World 4 was completely done, but for whatever reasons, it was not done. Let it be, not a problem. But you have done a good work.
Thank you, sir.
Team 18, we can go next. Please raise your hands.
Yeah. Hello, am I audible?
Hello, Saurabh. Will you be only presenting?
Yeah. My teammate couldn't be present here, so I will be only presenting.
Okay, so you could start presenting, then we can start the time.
Yeah, one second. I hope the slides are visible.
Yes, the slide is visible. Yeah. So, in meeting, your time starts now.
Yeah. We are presenting our model for DRDO UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. Our team ID is Team 18. And firstly, we would like to describe about the problem statements and the specifications which were given to us. So the problem statement was, we needed to map an area with a UAV aerial imaginary and navigate an UGV vehicle in that complex environment. What the software specifications were given? So these were the software specifications which we use. These were the Ubuntu 18.4 version we use, ROS Melodic. Gazebo 9 we use for simulation, and all the coding and the simulating part was done in Python library. Next, we will be coming to our approach. So initially, we thought of using a drone to traverse the entire road and the map, and then the entire traverse road and the map would be sent to the UGV so that the UGV would travel the road. But we found that it was taking more time than necessary, and also it was a little complex algorithm which we had to use. So we developed another approach. So the current approach which we are using is that the drone at a particular instant detects the road, and follows the road. If the road detection is not happening in a particular way or it is not satisfactory, the redetection of the road occurs, decreasing its error. Once the road once the drone has detected the road properly, we move on to the next phase, which is the drone detects the coordinates of the car, which we use to control. The coordinates of the car are then detected with respect to the actual image, with respect to the actual center of the road. This helps us for navigating the car through the given terrain at a given instant. Again, this also has a feature that if at a given instant we are not able to detect the contour of the car according to our necessity, we redetect coordinates, removing the error. And finally, the car moves the road mapped by the drone at a particular instant. Now, I will be sharing some algorithms and techniques which we have used for developing. So basically, four algorithms were used. First is the drone controlling and ROS integration in that. Then is the road detection, which we have used. Then we have the car position detector. And then we have the finally the car controller. Now we have used ROS server and services for the movement part. We take four inputs in the drone detection part. These are the X coordinate, Y coordinate, Z coordinate, and the angle of rotation around the Z axis. So this helps us to map, to take the drone at a elevated level, map the area using the depth camera and the RGB camera, which we use for the image contour detections, which we will be discussing in the further algorithms. Yeah, so in the road detection, we try to find the largest contour in the road from X minus margin to X plus margin. Now the X here, X is the road level, which is taken as the average pixel value at the center of the image. So this is the value which we use for detecting the center of the image. And this center of the image is what we take as the road detection. And now, after we get the center of the image, we define some margins so that anything which is outside these margins would not be taken as the part of the road. And this helps to map the contour of the road. In this way, we are able to get the centroid of the road, and this helps us to map the road properly. Two other parts of the road are also evaluated in this process. The second part is the elevation process. Suppose we have two consecutive images. The first image is divided into two parts. The upper part of the first image and the lower part of the second image set the X value in such a way that for the first image, upper part, the X value is taken for the contour detected in the above image. And whatever this contour is detected for the above part of the first image, this we use as the X part for the second image, so that there is no discontinuity even if the road is elevating. So this helps us to map the road continuously without any error. Next, for the part of angle detection, the angle detection works in a similar way as we did said about elevation detection, but instead of the two images which we are using consecutively, we use a single image, and in that single image we divide again the image into two parts, and for the two parts we try to derive the centroids. Now the once the centroids for the two parts are derived, we try to take an angle between those two parts with respect to the center of the lower part. So this gives us angle at what angle the road is turning, and this helps us to properly navigate through the road even if there are turns. Now coming on to the car detection part. So for the car detection part, we have used OpenCV as image processing to get the contours within a specified region. The way we have manipulated the images is such that what we assume is that the car will always be in the lower part of the image. So in a particular specific boundary region, we try to get all the contours. Now we after getting all the contours, we take the contours which are in the road detection area. Once these contours are detected, we also take the contours which are greater area than 200. So this helps us to eliminate all the unnecessary contours, and finally we get the contour which is exactly mapping our car. Now once we get the contour for our car, we draw a rectangular boundary around the car to get the coordinates of the car, and once we get the coordinates, we try to derive the centroid of the car. Now, after getting the centroid of the road and the centroid of the car, we are able to manipulate the car to move in a particular direction. Now, the car controller tries to keep the car in motion synchronized with the motion of the drone. For it, it finds the difference in the x and the y coordinates of the center of the frame and the position of the car. The car tries to move forward to the center of the road by given signals on the topic Pyrus. We have defined two errors, Y error and X error. X error is with difference between the center of the road and the center of the car. And Y error is also the same error, but in the Y direction. So once we get the two errors, what we use it as we need the car to navigate to the center of the road. We use the Y error to apply the brakes and the throttle. So if the Y error is positive, we apply the brakes. And if the Y error is negative, we apply the throttle. These are calibrated according to the worlds we are given. And these have accordingly a factor according to which the throttle and the brake values are calibrated. Similarly, for the X error, we try to calculate how much steering needs to be done. So if the X error is positive, we do the positive steering in the right direction. And if the X error is negative, we try to do the steering in the left direction. This also has a factor which helps us to calibrate according to our needs and the worlds which we were given. Now, finally, coming on to the results part. Results which here we have shown an RQT graph which helps us to show various ROS topics which are used for communicating the drone control. These are all the ROS topics used for drone control, and it helps us to control the drone, take it to a proper elevated level, get the images which we require for the contour detection parts. Next, road detection. As we have mentioned earlier before, we divide the image into two parts, and for the image which we have divided, we get these two centroids. Obviously, now if we line up the centroids, we get the angle with respect to the lower part of the centroid. Now, similarly, if there are two consecutive images, the upper centroid and the lower centroid are matched for the two consecutive images, and these X margins and the X values are accordingly derived. Lastly, this is the centroid of the car which we detect using the car detection algorithm which I have discussed earlier. Finally, the result is that we are able to properly control the drone using the ROS services. It is able to detect and maneuver the road for a proper passage. Then the car is able to follow the path sent by the drone. The car and drone maintain a safe distance from each other so that the car doesn't face any sudden change in the trajectory or doesn't need to manipulate its parameter ridiculously. So the proper communication is maintained between a drone and the car in a perfect sync using a control system. So that will be all. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Team 18. Just one question. Why couldn't you attend this demo yesterday?
Sir, we haven't sent the back packages. We were not able to give it within the required time segment. So actually, our team member was not there in the meet. So actually, I have the videos for two worlds. I can share it now if you wish, sir, which the test worlds which we are given to us.
Can you just play anyone?
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Sure.
What about word 3 and 4?
Yes, sir. Currently, we don't have the videos for that, but we also were having some errors for getting that part. One second, I will share this. Yes, sir. I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible. Right.
So this is the detection we did for the world one, sir.
Can you play it a bit faster?
Yes, yes, I am actually trying to. So as you can see, the depth image is there, and we are able to manipulate the depth image and accordingly maneuver the drone over that image. So this is one of the, and I will share another video, sir, in the same time. Yes. Here we can see, sir, the UGV also moving along with the drone along the mapped road. And again, we are showing the UAV navigation part for the drone. Yeah, sir, this was the one of the issues we faced was, sir, we are not able to properly integrate the control part of the car, which helps us to maneuver the over the road properly. So that was one of the issues which we are facing. Yes.
So like from your solution, I could see that you have done a lot of effort, and I was hoping that you could come yesterday, but we congratulate you for the very good solution that you
proposed. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir, and sorry for the part we were not able to propose.
The best for the future.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions from anyone else in the panelists? So we can go ahead to the next team. Thank you so much, team 18.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Team 17, you can raise your hands. Okay, team 17, you can start presenting, then we can start the time. Also, further instructions, your presentation will be of 10 minutes. At the end of the 8th minute, you will hear this buzzer sound, and I'll inform you when your presentation is time is over. Okay, so team 17, your time starts now.
Is it visible?
Hello, sir. This is Taniya Adityan. We are from team 17. We'll be presenting the statement of now. So, next slide. So, first, like, we'll discuss about the problem. So, our problem requires the UAV will be there. It is required to survey the whole environment. And based on that, it should like generate map, and it will send the generate the map and path, and it will send the commands, basic commands for the UGV to move around the terrain. So next slide, please. So the approach we have taken is mentioned here. Firstly, we have used a mission planner and audio pilot for the UAV survey. So using the auto mode survey in mission planner, we have like surveyed in this exact manner. And based on that, we have collected depth maps and the aerial map, and then we have geotagged each and every image. And based on that image we have geotagged, we had made some segmentation model, and we have segmented the road. And like after segmenting the road, we have added waypoints over the path. And based on that, the UAV receives the waypoint coordinates, and then based on that the UGV is moved. So some of the software stack we use is like ROS Melodic 18.4 and Gazebo. RDA Pilot and Mavros. So moving on to the next slide.
So the UAV operation is controlled using the UAV flight stack, which involves the flight controller, that is the RD Pilot software. The simulation is based on the SITL, that is the software in the loop, and through a communication layer, which is the Mavlink protocol, it communicates to the map proxy ground station, ground control station. So that is how the UAV is commanded. The car is tracked with the aerial image that we get. So the heading of the car is determined from the aerial image using thresholding. So now for the initial part, we survey the whole map given the extent of the area. We create a zigzag path or a Bostrophedon path. The UAV will survey the whole area, collecting both depth maps and RGBD maps. With that, we stitch them and create the final map. So initially, with the given image overlay, we try to implement the road extraction machine learning algorithm. This is like a segmentation algorithm where roads are detected and roads are and non-roads are segmented. So basically, the white represents the roads and the black represents the non-roads. This was for the time when the problem statement was based on the image overlay, but when the problem statement changed to the plane overlay, we switched to a approach where we use depth image detection. So in that we find the depth plane detection in the depth images.
As my fellow explained, first we were thinking about in-vane segmentation for it detecting road from the aerial images, but as we were not getting a satisfactory result with the plane overlay, we switched to depth map way of detection of roads. So in that, what we did, we used a paper which is mentioned here, mapping on the fly, and they also have GitHub repo for that. So we use their package and we try to create a digital surface map of the terrain that our UGV has to move on. So in that, what it does is just kind of a change of point of view. So it detects the road and stitches the discrete images and arranges them in in the georeference way. So that was the part for detection of roads from depth images. Now what we have to do is, from these images we have to extract roads. So for that, we tried to use as in the given environment, the road was sufficiently very close enough to a plane. So what we did was detect plane detection from depth images, which incorporates as the terrain was very rough. So what we tried was to extract the plane features from the pseudo image, that is grayscale, from the depth maps, and from that we tried to extract the roads, and then to we skeletonize the road so that we can obtain a line segment that a UGV can follow.
So
because that was the part for detecting the roads and roads from the terrain and distinguishing the roads from the depth images. Now comes the part where we have to control the UGV and to track it on the correct path. We used image thresholding because the environment was sufficiently like easy to consider it as the road has a constant color gradient and the terrain is some like distinguishable visually. So we just used image thresholding for distinguishing the car from the road, and then for detecting the heading and all.
Yeah, so we use image thresholding for detection of heading and orientation of UGV. We set threshold values and convert the images, RGB images from the UAV to a binary images containing only white and black pixels. Then we generate a minimum area rectangle to locate UGV and its heading. So that's shown in this figure, how we detect the heading and the UGV. And further moving on to next slide. We use A-star algorithm for generating array of waypoints that UGV has to transfer to the reach the target destination. After generation of map, we pass that to a Python script that converts uses A-star algorithm to generate the path for the UGV. We use spline interpolation to smoothen sharp turns. We use cubic spirals because they are more smoother than circular, while they are computationally much better than quintic polynomials. So we use cubic spirals for smooth turns. Then coming to the UGV movement, we created a ROS node named string generator, which took as input the array of waypoints and converted into it into a string of commands like go straight, go left, go right, that sort, using the cross product function. Given we have three points x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, we detect right turns and left turns using the cross product. If cross product is greater than zero, it's a left turn. If it is less than zero, it's right turn. Or if it is equals to zero, we have to go to go straight. So we created a ROS node which converted the string of commands to the required format, which slash prior topic required, which is of control message. We published it the values of throttle, steer, brake according to our needs, and hence we were able to control the UGV movement. Thank you.
Very good, Team 17. You seem to have read a lot about it and taken so many references, and I think you have implemented also. Can I just know the reason that why yesterday it was not running?
Sir, actually, what happened yesterday, one thing we realized, we should have realized at that time only, because the computer we were running, actually the car was moving there. The real-time factor was 0.09, so it was not visually appearing to move. The second thing was, that was the part yesterday, things were not working, test part was not working. The second thing was, we were actually, some features that we mentioned in the PPT, we were not able to integrate them. We tried to implement them separately, but when it comes to implementing it in a single application, we were not able to do that. Maybe because we started ROS in this PS only, most of our members have just been introduced to ROS in the last 15 days only. So we were not able to sufficiently utilize the resources we mentioned. Okay. So those were the reasons, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay, don't lose heart. So 21 days is a very less time actually. So I congratulate you that your team members have learned a new thing. And now I'm sure that in future you will do very well. Because I could see from your presentation that you have worked a lot. Yes, sir. All the best to your team.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
If there are no other questions, we can move ahead to the next team.
Yeah, we can move it.
Okay. Team 6, please raise your hands. Team 6, please raise your hands. So I'll give the instructions. Team, your presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of the 8th minute, you'll hear a buzzer sound. And at the end of the presentation, I'll inform you. Followed by that, we'll have a Q&A. Okay, your time starts now.
Hello, am I audible?
Oh yes, you're audible.
Yeah, so we are Team 6 and we're presenting for the DRDO UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. So essentially the problem statement is to map an area with a UAV and using aerial imagery and then guide a UGV through a complex static environment which is present there. So this includes navigating various turns, changes in altitude and in some cases complete 180 turns. So to achieve this, we're simulating in Gazebo and using ROS, Autopilot, Mavros as our like standard software libraries. We are also using YOLO for doing some rudimentary object detection and getting some like position data. So I'd like to switch it over to Pranit.
So our approach for the problem statement is first we'll recognize the terrain. So the RGBD camera on the quadcopter is capable of having depth images. And for terrain recognition, we'll get into the details later. Then we have a road mapping module where we identify and path, like plot the path for the UGV with the help of the drone. Next is the UGV. So since the UGV doesn't have any sensors, so we need to send messages from the drone itself to control, and we'll get the position and all using the quadcopter itself. And the last one is the feedback mechanism. So basically it is a real-time feedback loop, and the feedback we are using YOLO for the feedback mechanism, and basically it just like gives us the real-time position of the UGV.
So the way this works is that the way this works is that we take the bounding box of the detection part from YOLO, and using that we determine the center of the bounding box and use that as the position of our of the UGV. So following this, we make use of the point cloud library or PCL to detect the roads. So the way this works is that we use PCL and ROS transform. So we compute basically a first a normal point cloud, then we use an algorithm to determine what is our ground plane. Finally, we like drive segmentation and refine our outputs, and we extract the extended regions in the point cloud. Finally, we publish this data into our ROS, and so that we can get a detailed position of the UGV.
For the main tracking of the UGV, we are planning to use a pure pursuit method. So pure pursuit, it's a very common approach in part tracking for robotic applications. So it basically consists of calculating curvatures of a circular arc that connects the axle of the vehicle to the next goal point. So the goal point, it's the set of points which you'll get from the PCL approach that Akshay just explained. So essentially we can determine what the vehicle steering angle should be so that we'll reach the goal point location. We're just using a basic PID controller to a sort of keep in check that we are not deviating too much from our path.
So about the feedback mechanism, so basically we are using Darknet, which is basically a neural network, and YOLO, which is like an image detection framework. So basically from the RGBD camera, we'll get a point cloud, and the YOLO, which will give us the bounding box of the car. So using the bounding box, we'll get the coordinates of the center and also the depth image, the point cloud of it. And combining these two, we can get the exact position of the pixel position of the UGV. So basically this is a acts in real time, and it publishes the position of frequently so that the UGV can be controlled.
So this was basically our approach. So we were not able to complete it fully. We are still implementing all the modules together. And at this point, we'll like to thank DRDO for providing us with this opportunity. This was a very valuable skill addition to all of our team. And just like to thank DRDO.
Thank you, Team 6, for your, I'm sure that each one of the participants, each one of the team, they learned a lot while solving this particular problem. 21 days or maybe less than 21 days, it's actually very less time to solve such a kind of problem. But we really congratulate your team that you have put up such a nice presentation here today. Any question from other panelists? Otherwise, I'll ask them a question.
Have you made any kind of simulations which you can show? Any graphs or something?
No, sir. We were not able to fully get a cohesive solution. We are just trying to get the individual models working up till this point.
Okay.
Pranit, what is that one thing that you could have got and your simulation would have been done?
So I guess time. We are definitely planning to carry this forward and make this sort of a mini project. Do this amongst ourselves and get a solution.
Very good, very good. So how much more time?
Once the
deadline of the competition is over, we generally tend to
slack off.
Become a bit lazy.
So that is why
I'm asking you for a self-set deadline so that you can move on that particular deadline and complete the problem. So do that. Okay.
Yes, absolutely. Like we are already like in primitive works of taking this as a mini project amongst ourselves.
Very good. Very good. So all the best to your team.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Bye bye.
Team two, you will be going next. Please raise your hand.
Hello, am I audible? Hello, am I audible?
Please go ahead. Harshil, please go ahead.
Yes, yes.
Now, this is team number?
Two, team two.
Number two, okay.
I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it is visible.
All right.
Okay, so your team two, your time starts now. And
hello.
Also.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead, Muskan.
Okay, so I'll stop your time. I'll just give the instruction. Your time will for this like start again. Like your presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of the 8th minute, I will like you will hear this buzzer sound, and at the end of 10 minutes, I'll inform you that your time is over.
Followed by which we will
have a Q&A session.
All right, all right.
Okay, so your time starts again.
Hello, we are team two, and this is our solution presentation for the UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. So this year, the problem statement was quite interesting, where a UAV had to guide a UGV to traverse an unknown terrain. And I think the significance of this problem statement was quite big, because it is derived from real life scenarios where sometimes army vehicles might have derailed on mountainous terrains in zero visibility due to snow in the winters. So this is something that our solution will combat. Our solution is basically divided into two parts. So the first part is known as summer mapping, and the second part is known as winter tracking. So the summer mapping involves a drone that will basically detect a road and track it until the end of the road, and in the process store waypoints for the car to follow. Then these stored waypoints will be passed into the winter tracking module, where the winter tracking module consists of a car which has a controller that can track any reference trajectory. It also consists of the drone that is able to detect the car and give localization information to it. And in the process, as the car is moving along the road, it will keep detecting the car and track it until the end of the road. So moving on, I'll explain both of these parts in detail. But first, let's see how they work cohesively together in the decision-making framework. So we've just used a simple state machine wherein the drone takes off and checks if the road has been mapped. Because the first time it will not have been mapped, the summer mapping module is initiated, where the drone takes off, detects the road, tracks the road, and stores trajectories. Once that happens, the winter tracking module is initiated, where the drone resets, takes off again, and then detects the car and localizes the car, sends localization information to the car, and gives the trajectory commands to the car. So then the car tracks the trajectory given by the summer mapping module, and the mission then ends as the car follows the road. So now I'll talk about the summer mapping module in detail. So the main goal of this module is to basically for the drone to detect the road to track the road until the end, storing waypoints in the process. So to detect the road, we use road segmentation, where basically we only use the depth image. We did not use the RGB image here because across the world, there was a wide variety of color information across the roads. And so any one algorithm was not performing suitably in those conditions. But moreover, the road segmentation using depth image would work perfectly because the depth of the road was sort of something that was differentiating in all of those three worlds that we got. So we convert the whole depth image into grid cells, and then each cell is assigned a value of depth values that is average of the depth of all of the points inside the cell. And then we implement a 3D regression to fit a 2D horizontal plane onto the grid. Once we do that, then we can calculate the error threshold for each of the cells by converting the error into error for each of the cells into percentile and then selecting the most probable range. So now we have a detected road, but now we want the drone to track the road. So what we do then is to send position set points to the drone to track the road. So for that, on the image of the segmented road, we use a custom convolution kernel to filter out the edge and noise. And then we predict the future yaw of the drone by calculating the gradient of a polynomial that is fit on the edge of the road that is being detected. The next waypoint is then being predicted by calculating the heading on the centered road. So if two edges are being detected, the next waypoint is basically the center of the two edges. And if only one of the edges is being detected, we predict the next set point by seeing our orientation with respect to the drone. So if we're on the left of the road or on the right of the road. If none of the edges are being detected, we just go back to the previous waypoint where we continue detection again and then move on from there. So now the left GIF that you see is basically our demonstration for the summer mapping where the drone is tracking the road. Moving on, for tracking of the drone, for the drone to track the trajectory given, we use a simple position target message that is used to command the drone through Arduino in the gazebo. This is for the position set points. For the yaw correction, we use a P controller in the yaw axis. So basically, that is that uses the difference between the current yaw of the drone and the required yaw in the trajectory. So now we have finished the summer mapping module. We have a trajectory for the car to follow. So in the winter tracking module, what we basically need is a controller for the car so that the car can follow the trajectory and for the drone to be able to detect the car and send localization information. So to detect the car, we tried a number of different methods like Canius detection and Sobel edge filter. These are standard computer vision techniques. Once we had sufficient results in those, we tried various machine learning techniques like key point detectors on Canius and Sobel. So the second and the third row that you see here are our key point detector implementations on Cani and on Sobel respectively. After we got better results on those, then we finalized a pipeline where you can see we've taken an RGB image and pass it through Cani and Sobel and then apply a third additional step, which is the adaptive thresholding step. Post this step, we can easily find contours on the image. So we found contours and then because we got multiple contours, we sort those contours by area and then draw the bounding box around the largest contour, which is the car itself. So once we have the bounding box, then it is pretty trivial to find the center of the car and the angle of the car. The angle is basically equal to the slope of the longest side. So this is just what I talked about in the previous slide, so I'll skip this. The left GIF that you see here is actually the pipeline integration of all the steps that I talked about in our final approach before. So these are the individual steps that you can see for the car detection. Moving on, now that the car can be detected and we can pass localization information to it, the only step that is left is for the car to track the trajectory. So for that, we basically estimate the car to have a bicycle model, which can take in two inputs, that is steer and throttle. So once we have waypoints from the summer mapping module, we can fit a cubic spline to that to those points and generate a trajectory. And so for each point on the trajectory, then we can calculate a radius of curvature. And then the radius of curvature can be passed on into a velocity controller, which will give us the instantaneous throttle that needs to be maintained. To calculate the steer, we used a Stanley controller, which was developed by the Stanford University for the DARPA challenge. The Stanley controller basically uses a control law that takes in two error terms, the cross-track error term and the heading error term. The cross-track error term is basically the distance between the front axle and the instantaneous trajectory. And the heading error is the difference between the current yaw of the car and the desired yaw that is fed in through the trajectory. So yeah, now we have a car that is being detected by the drone and which can move onto any given trajectory. So these are again the points that I said in the previous slide. So this is the demonstration for the summer for the winter tracking module on World 2, where the drone takes off and follows the car. So we'll just wait for the car to track the road. So yeah, as the car moves along, the drone then follows the car and gives localization information to the car. Yeah, moving on, we felt a further few improvements that we want to implement in the future are to implement a model predictive controller for both the UGV and for the UAV. This is because we felt that sometimes the car and the drone both did overshoot when turns suddenly approached and turns which were like 180 degree turns. So a model predictive controller would sort of combat that because it would basically predict any coming turn and then change the throttle and the steer accordingly. Another thing is that we could have used semantic segmentation, which is basically a machine learning heavy model. Currently, because the problem statement was changed midway to include only the white overlay, that's why we kept a very lean approach. Yeah, so because of the lean approach that we used, we did not use any heavy machine learning models, which is something that could have given us better results. But if I go further down the line, I can say that that is sort of a huge advantage of our implementation, that all of our modules are very lightweight and they can be run on any sort of low cost, cheap architecture that is available on everyday drones and cars. Further, on the request of Mr. Sudhir yesterday, I would like to present our World 4 implementation for that as well. So if you could just give me a minute. So yeah, this is our World 4 implementation video post the live demonstration that we had yesterday. So again, the drone takes off, detects the car. The video is sped up, obviously, for the interest of time. But the drone takes off, detects the car, and then the car starts moving along. And the drone also follows the car. So that is it from our side. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Team 2, for the excellent work that you have done. And I could see that you have used many niche algorithms in the solution that you have provided. Just tell me the one thing that because of which you this car couldn't move yesterday. Like, it was going haywire. It was not following the path that the UAV had mapped.
So, sir, actually, yesterday when we ran the summer mapping algorithm, we could get a waypoint list for the road. And then we had to basically run a file that was for data pre-processing that would smoothen out the trajectory and basically calculate the waypoints of the road from the edges that were being detected. But that file did not run yesterday because we found out that we had actually commented out a line of code for testing purposes before. And so when we did actually find that error and uncomment that crucial part of the line, then that was the result that you saw in the video right now, where the car could follow the road and the drone could follow the car. So our solution did work then. It was just a human error on that part yesterday.
The most unfortunate thing to happen.
Yeah.
So anyways, the solution was quite impressive. I could see from your presentation. And maybe you can share the whole World 4 video with us.
So currently, I don't think I have the whole World 4 video. What I just showed you was a little snippet of the video because...
Okay, not a problem. So all the best to your team.
Thank you so much.
Very good work.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. Any questions from Akshay or Kripal's side?
Nothing much. Go ahead.
Okay then, Team 2. Thank you so much. Congratulations to whole of your team and all the best for the future.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Team 11, you can go next. Please raise your hands.
This was Team 2, right, Muskan?
Yes, sir. Okay, team 11. So following other instructions for the presentation, your presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of the 8th minute, you will hear this buzzer sound. And at the end of 10 minutes, I'll inform you that your time is over. It would be followed by a Q&A session. So you can present now, and then we can start the time.
Good morning, everyone. This is
Team 11. Team 11. Your time starts now.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. This is Team 11, and this is a presentation for our approach to the UAV-guided UGV navigation challenge. So our approach consists of two main modules, the navigation module and the UGV UAV control module. In the navigation module, we have three subparts, the road detection, wherein we receive the depth image from the UAV and obtain, in the end, a road mask that highlights what part of the image we estimate to be the road. From that road mask, we pass, which we pass to the UGV detection and path planning modules. We first obtain an estimate of the UGV pose and orientation. And in the path planning module, we obtain an estimate of the target set point that we want to pass to the UGV. In the control module, we have two subparts. The first where we set the UAV to follow the UGV using a PD controller. And in the second subpart, we make the UGV follow the target set point obtained from the path planning module. Our main philosophy with our approach is to make it as simple as possible. Therefore, we try to stick to the most basic elements and see how much performance we could extract from that. So for the road detection subpart, we first receive a depth image from the UAV depth camera captured between the heights of 15 to 20 meters. Next, we apply Sobel filters, wherein we take gradients of the image. And because this is the depth image, this gives us which parts of the terrain captured are steep. And because the road is going to be more or less flat, therefore the road gets highlighted as black. Then we invert this image and threshold it so that the road is obtained as white. However, we see that there is some noise in the corners and in the center of the UGV. To remove this noise, first we perform morphological opening, wherein isolated parts of the white white image are removed. Therefore, we are left with larger connected components. Our assumption after this is that the road is going to be the major component visible in the image. Therefore, we extract the largest component. And a side effect of this is that there is a black blob present in the middle of the road, which is the UGV. So this image is then passed to the path detection and the UGV detection components.
Yes, coming to the UGV detection part, we'll detect the UGV in the road mask, which was generated from the road detection module. So in this image, we can see that the car appears as a small black shape in the center of the road. So this we can retrieve as the smallest component in the image, as the other components present in the road mask are the sides of the road and the road itself. So we'll be selecting this smallest component by using the contour detection, where we'll fit a minimum area bounding rectangle over the car, which gives us an estimation of the car's pose. So the longer edge of the UGV is taken to be the orientation of the UGV, and the center is determined from the four corners of the bounding rectangle. Now, coming to the path planning part, we need to know the direction in which the UGV has to move ahead. So for that, we draw a horizontal line at a certain distance above the UGV and consider the midpoint of the line, which lies in the road, so the which would be our target set point. So the vector from the UGV's current center to the target set point would be the direction in which the UGV has to follow.
Now let us look at the controller module of our algorithm. So in the UGV controller, from the steer direction that we had calculated using the detection module, we pass this steer direction to the UGV such that it can navigate forward along the path. And for the UAV controller, we calculated the UGV center, orientation, and its forward direction. And using these three vectors, we pass these to the UAV controller such that the UAV first aligns itself with the orientation of the UGV, such that the UAV and UGV are always facing in the same direction. And after the direction is aligned, then the UAV navigates towards the UGV center such that the UAV always hovers above the UGV. Now here let us look at the workflow of our algorithm. So first we take the depth feed from the depth camera and we pass it through the image gradient. After that we apply the thresholding layer, which gives us the mask that we had seen earlier. Now using this mask, we segment this mask into two modules, the road detection module and the car detection module. In the road detection module, we calculate the target steer direction in which the car should follow such that it can be able to follow the path. We pass the steer direction to the UGV controller, which gives the required velocities to the car. From the car detection module, we get the car's local position with respect to the drone so that the drone can know where the car is and can follow the car as the car follows the path. These car local positions are passed to the UGV controller and the UAV controller, and the desired velocities are passed to the drone and the cars.
Okay, so these are the different approaches that we tried. So for the road detection module, we tried using Laplacian for the better detection of the edges of the roads. And for the thresholding part, we also tried dynamic thresholding, because if you see the map, in some areas the gradients were very steep and some areas the gradients were not that steep. So using a dynamic threshold improves the results. And the standard way to do that was to use a OTSU method, or we could use multi-OTSU thresholding also. Another method that we tried was by just having the raw depth images, we could just set up a thresholding value and get the road detected. And for the car detection module, from the mast images that you saw earlier, we could use canny edge detection to get the bounding rectangle or the rotated bounding rectangle of the car. Also, we could train our own HAAR cascade. So by giving the top view images of the car, we could train our HAAR cascade to detect the car in the map. Also, for estimating the pose of the car, we tried using principal component analysis. Another approach that we tried was the opposite of what was discussed earlier, that is the UGV following the UAV. So in simple words, first the drone was made to follow the path. And if the error between the path and the drone came in between a certain optimum value, the drone center will then be marked on the image, and then the car will be given a velocity towards the drone center. The drone was made to follow the path because centering of the drone on the path is much more easier than centering the car, because the drone has more degrees of freedom. And because the drone has more degrees of freedom, it can move in any vector direction in its own plane. But the car needs to steer and throttle, and that needs to be calibrated a lot. And there were certain offsets that we provided for the throttle and steering of the car to achieve that. Also, there was one more parameter, that if the UGV and UAV get apart from each other by a particular amount of distance, but again, they have to be in a screen, like the image that the drone can see, to be detected. The car needs to be detected. So if they move apart by a certain distance, what will happen is whichever one will be ahead, that will stop for some time and it will wait for the other one to catch it up.
So given this approach, some improvements that we thought of that might help our algorithm, especially if given more time or resources, would be to first try using an RL-based controller for the UGV. In the test worlds, the terrain was not that complicated. There were no obstacles in the road, but in real life, there might be certain obstacles or certain parts of the road that are not accessible. So for that, you could possibly train an RL-based controller so that the UGV is able to navigate the terrain with more ease. Apart from that, our approach used local mapping. So there was no pre-computation step involved where we had to map the entire terrain. However, we recognize that sometimes we need more context than just the current frame to be able to robustly detect the path. So for that, what we propose is that whenever the road is ambiguous, then we stop all motion, that is the UGV and UAV, and we let the UAV map its current location. So maybe a few meters forward behind its current location to be able to get a better idea of the ground reality, ground truth in that specific location. Thirdly, another thing that would have helped the algorithm immensely is having a functioning gimbal on the UAV. Because what we found was that whenever the drone had to move, it would pitch in the direction it wants to move. And this would cause the vertical alignment of the camera to be off. And therefore, the road would appear steep, which would cause problems with the thresholding. if there was a gimbal, we could have maintained vertical alignment of the camera, and this would have allowed our road detection algorithm to be much more robust. Apart from this, a couple more things that midway through the problem statement time, we were told that we were shown how the road would look in the second phase of the navigation, that there would be a white overlay. And if we had known this beforehand, we would have definitely used the RGB image to detect the car much more robustly. Whereas here, we just use the depth image. Thank you very much. That's all from our side. We're open to questions.
Thank you so much. Your team number is 11, right?
Yes.
Okay. So team 11, yesterday I could see that you were doing the mapping and navigation all together live. But the movement was not much. So what could be the reason behind that?
So here actually, I think since the mapping was, the masking was not able to happen properly, one issue was with the gimbal, and the other issue was since the mapping or the masking was sensitive to the thresholding value. So since the thresholding value was different for each terrain, that is why the masking could not happen properly. So that was one issue that we faced. So because of the improper masking, the car was not able to detect properly, and hence the motion and the movement was not happening completely.
Okay. So now the scope of improvement that you have shown, you are proposing reinforcement learning, many more new things. Do you think it is possible on onboard on a UAV?
Yes, sir. Essentially,
H2 or ZV or something, boards like this.
Yes, sir. Essentially, the whole point of reinforcement learning is that first, given a certain situation, we want to reduce it to certain features that describe that situation. So the hard step in reinforcement learning would be to capture what the drone is seeing within a few parameters. After that, there is only the question of deciding on what would be the optimal policy given these parameters. So that is the advantage of reinforcement learning. Once we have reduced the dimensions of the problem statement itself,
okay.
Then the computations are much easier.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So whole of the solution that now you are proposing, it is possible on a drone.
Yes, definitely. That's our whole approach. We wanted to keep it as lightweight as possible, which is why we tried HARCascade and a few other machine learning approaches, but we started from basic image processing itself to see how far we could go with that. And I believe we did achieve a remarkable result because we were able to detect the road very accurately whenever the drone was stationary at the very least, without pitch.
Okay. Any other question from the image?
So the problem with the mapping and navigating at the same time is in during snow conditions, you may not able to estimate the depth of the road correctly because the road is filled with snow and everything looks planar. So it's better to map it first beforehand and then sort of navigate it during winter times. Also, if there is if you're only using the depth camera information, if there's a river flowing alongside the road in the valley region, you may not able to differentiate road with river.
Yeah, so for that, since with the given worlds, we didn't face that issue, so we didn't incorporate the RGB. But in our algorithm, the algorithm is open for the RGB integration also. So since the white overlay was there, and the depth camera was working with the depth images itself, we were able to achieve a decent results. So we didn't incorporate the RGB feed, but in future improvements, we can certainly inculcate the RGB feed also, so that the river issue, that is a real problem that we could overcome. And for the height correction, like we have added the height correction so that the drone and the car are always at a fixed height. So we are calculating how high our drone is above the car, and we are keeping it at a certain height so that it is able to get a decent enough context of where the road is and where the car is. So hopefully that the layer of ice issue would be overcome with that.
Okay, very good, Team 11. Thank you so much for participating in this event, and I was really impressed with the solution that you have given. It would have been very good if yesterday in demo your team would have reached across the whole world. But I'm sure that when you are sitting at home and doing it again, you'll be able to do it. So all my best and best wishes to your team.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Keep up the good work. We can, Muskan, we can go ahead to the next team.
Okay, sir. Team 14, please raise your hands. Oh, hello, sir. Am I audible?
Yes, Muskan, you are audible.
Okay, sir. I'm inviting one more person. Ariman Gupta, can you please accept the invite? Harsh, please accept the invite.
भाई निकल ले फ्रेम से एकदम और
Ajman, please accept the invite. Okay, so team 14, following on these instructions for the presentation, your presentation will go on for 10 minutes. At the end of 8 minutes, you will hear this buzzer sound. After that, at the end of 10 minutes, I'll inform you that your time is up. It would be followed by a Q&A session. You can present your screen so that we can start the time.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, team 14, your time starts now.
Good morning, respected judges and everyone present here. We are team 14 and we are going to present a solution for DRDO's UAV guided UGV navigation challenge. This year's PS was about guiding a UGV along a road on a mountainous terrain with the aid of a UAV, which has pre-mapped the terrain with the help of the UAV's GPS, IMU and RGBD camera. So coming to phase one, the mapping phase, Our approach has 5 parts: the UAV altitude and position control, semantic segmentation of the road using the RGBD data, real-time mapping with the help of frontier navigation to create a map of the entire road. So starting off, the first thing that we started with was UAV localization. That is estimating the position of the UAV using the GPS data and the IMU data. So the challenge here was to fuse the absolute GPS latitude and longitude, which we were getting at a rate of 100 Hertz, and the position as calculated by double integrating the IMU accelerations, also at a rate of 100 Hertz, and then feeding both to an extended Kalman filter to finally get the filter odometry data. So here's a quick demo in ARVIS. So as you can see, as the drone starts moving up, the odometry gets updated. Basically, the drone is moving up like this. So, and coming to how accurately we estimated the position of the UAV, we cross-validated our UAV pose by transforming the pose of the UAV in the gazebo world to the ODOM frame, that is the initial start frame. And the error margin turned out to be 0.5 meters at max in all the three axes. Then for controlling the drone position and altitude, we simply used the Rostovic Mavro setpoint position global, and the rest is handled by the Ardu Pilot mission planner. I now hand over to Aryaman. Aryaman?
So the next task we had to do was the road segmentation. We thought of two approaches to do road segmentation using OpenCV and threshold, two different class methods, OpenCV and holding, and the next was learning-based methods. Next slide. For classical methods, we had a few problems. The texture of road and terrain were very similar to each other. There were shadows which also had similar features, and the resolution of images obtained from the camera had very low resolution, which made it difficult to do finer segmentation of finer features. So we discarded the road segmentation approach and went with the semantic segmentation model. For semantic segmentation, the requirement was decent segmentation, which led us model like V3 and UNET with encoders like MobileNet, Inception, and ResNet 18. For the model to be computationally, we used UNET with ResNet 18, which had a pretty good inference time, and we went use that as our final model. We had to generate our own data for model training. We used the CVAT annotation online tool for data generation. And for printing the data, because we had very less amount of data, we need some amount of augmentation. We use resizing, rotating, horizontal, and vertical as augmentation so that the features of the road remain the same. And we could still generate more data. And this led to better results. Next, we started training the unit with ResNet encoder. We use Adam optimizer with learning rate 2e minus 3 to 5e minus 8 with binary cross entropy as the loss, because it gives a better results with semantic segmentation. We ran for 10,000 hops, and we have a good result with accuracy data being 26.4%, which was the section over median accuracy. Inference time was 170 milliseconds, which was pretty good for real time detection and segmentation. Now, I would like to hand over to the next speaker.
Yeah, thank you, Arvin. Yeah, so for transform fixes, we had published a custom transform from the base link to the camera link optical for the RTAP mapping node, which I'll be explaining in the subsequent slides. Yeah, our mapping approach involves taking in the camera image and the segmented road image and passing it to the RTAP so that only the road is visible to the mapper. Next, RTAP creates a 2D projected map of the road, and we apply frontier exploration to the map image, which publishes the goal point to the mission planner of the Ardu Pilot. Next slide. Talking about RTAP map, it is a SLAM mapping node which localizes as well as creates a map of the environment through a loop closure approach, where it checks whether the robot has seen a location before or not, and then stitches up a map of the complete environment. Next slide. Moving on to the frontier exploration, the algorithm works by creating frontiers between explored and the unexplored regions, and the robot navigates towards them and creates a map. It subsequently creates another set of frontiers and repeats the step to map the entire map, environment. Yeah, next slide, Sandeep. Here is a short GIF of our UAV taking off and mapping the road segment. Yeah, so moving on. Yeah, as the map is prepared in phase one, let's move to the UGV navigation part. For its autonomous navigation, we first needed to localize it and then get the odometric. Then we established an autonomous control and made it autonomously traverse the road. Next slide. Let me give you an overview of our approach for getting odometry. We trained the YOLO V5 model to detect the UGV. We fused it with the depth images and masked out the UGV from the image and calculated the world coordinates using the information from the camera matrix from camera and frostopic. This gave us pose of the UGV. To get the velocity, we calculated the relative change in position. You can clearly see the results here. Yeah, next slide. We manually prepared the data set by collecting UAV's camera images, annotated them, and performed augmentation to get a decent data set. And then we trained the YOLO V5 model on our data set and got quite good results. As you can see here, the mean average precision scores are shown here. Yeah, next slide. Here you can see how accurately our model is detecting the UGV with the bounding box. Yeah, okay, next slide. Next slide. To get the orientation, you can see we fit an ellipse around the car and calculated the angle of the major axis, and you can see it's giving around 179 degrees, which is quite accurate. So moving on. The following are the flow charts explaining in just our approach for UGV tracking. You can see there. Over to Harsh for the later part of the presentation. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Vrat, for the presentation. Now we'll go into UGV controls part. So for UGP control, we first got the map, 2D projection map from RTAP, which was fed into TEP Global Planner. What TEP Global Planner did was to calculate a global plan for our car from the initial point to the final goal point. Then that plan was given to OMPL Local Planner. What OMPL Local Planner did was to break that whole global part into smaller parts that can be that are dynamic and can be easily followed by the car. So OMPL Local Planner also got the position of the car from the UAV, and it finally gave that part to PRS controller node, which published the required topics for the car to move. Also, there was a feedback from the feedback cycle from the UAV implemented. UGV for now, for what was inside that node? So inside that node, there was pure pursuit controller. What pure pursuit controller did was to calculate the angular velocities for some look ahead point, maintaining a constant linear velocity. And then it calculated that and gave that velocities on the required topics through which the car moved. Next one. Yeah. As discussed earlier, there are two part planning algorithms that we use: global planner, which is TEP global planner, time based elastic plan. Global planner and local planner, which is OMPL local planner, open motion planning library. So what TEP did is this, it locally optimizes robot trajectory with respect to the trajectory execution time, and it calculates the whole part. Whereas the local planner we use uses sampling based motion planning algorithms to calculate the local parts. Next slide, please. There were numerous challenges that we faced through solving this extensive PS. The main challenges we faced were configuration of UAV IMU axis, height optimization, that is maintaining the UAV at a constant height. We also found a lot of noise in the output image of unit models, along with latency in the processing. Also, there was low camera updated, and also we had low insufficient hardware specs that when we were running everything, our simulation was running in 0.1 RTF. Also, one of the major challenges we faced was scarcity of time for integrating our individual components. Like individual components, we have finished and were working nicely, but we could not integrate it in time. Next slide. Scope of improvement. The major scope of improvements that we think in our project are, first, we can improve the road segmentation by using a larger data set. We can do the mapping autonomously by choosing frontier on distance-based matrix. We can reduce the interference time of unit models and process the filtered image before feeding it to the RFAB. And also, we can improve the accuracy of our UGV detection for better tracking and control. Next slide. So this is our computational analysis, and this shows that our models were quite inexpensive and can be used in real life scenarios. So our Gazebo took two cores, RDO Pilot took 0.85 cores, and rest all are mentioned here. Next slide, please. So this is again the performance analysis of rest of these sites. You can see that this can be used in real life scenarios. Next slide. This is the system configurations that we used. This is our OS was Ubuntu 20.04, processor was Intel 11th gen, and our graphics was ZForce MX350. So that was for all from our side. Thank you for all the judges and all the organizers for providing us this opportunity to help our soldiers. Thank you. We are open to questions.
Thank you so much to your team. As I can see that you could fairly manage to assemble each and everything, But what happened? Like, why couldn't you turn up yesterday?
The thing is that we actually didn't get time enough to integrate all these individual subcomponents that we could do, right? So yeah, and the main problem was the drones part, especially. Like, we are lacking a bit in the drone expertise and experience, and so that was why we feel to do that. But other than that, the UGV part was almost done. Even the drones pipeline, everything was ready. Just that we couldn't integrate it in time.
So how much more time would you need now?
Around 2 days, we can solve
it. 2 more days and you're done?
Yep.
Oh, very good. So I hope that your team, all the team members must have got something to learn, some new skills.
Yeah.
In this challenge.
Definitely. Learning is always there.
Yeah. So good. I could see that you have got a very fairly well understanding of all the concepts that you have used now. And it's a good thing that you have also shown how much computational power is required for each of your solutions. So it gave me actually a lot of confidence, like, yeah, this is doable.
Thank you, sir. All right.
So any question from any panelists?
Sir, thank you.
Okay. So thanks to your team for participating, and we wish you the best for the next time.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, judges. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
This was the last team, sir.
Muskan, this was team number?
14.
This was team number 14, is it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next.
So this was the last team.
Okay. Fine. So actually, I've shared the spreadsheet with you that has all the marks. So team 14, I'm just noting down the marks, and you can open that particular sheet, and all the marks are there.
Okay. So yeah.
So shall we break here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you so much, Muskan. Thank you so much.